No, this is just a shirt. How's everyone doing? God, we got a lot of stuff. Good God. This is the, I've got to say downside, but the thing you have to contend with in PvE is you are going to have a lot of shit. A lot of shit. just gonna do a little bit of a little bit of talking. Apologize for the lateness. I was watching a documentary. If you haven't seen it, it's on. I think it's on HBO. So if you're in the UK, you get it on now. It is about this theme park, I guess you could call it, in America called Action Park in the 80s in New Jersey, and it's like a death trap. Like an actual death trap. People would die in there. All the employees were just kids. It's such a good documentary. It's really, really, really good. I mean, the weird thing is I remember stuff. I never went there because I was too young. Like, I think, I mean, I left the US when I was 8. It's time to goose. So I would have been too young. Ma juste zubède for 23 months. Merci. So, I mean, I wouldn't have even been aware of it. And yeah, so it's not like one of those things that I've got any recollection of whatsoever from when I lived in the States. It was one of those things where I remember going to, there was a Sesame Street theme park that was like, a lot of it was shut when we went there. I remember that. And I guess we probably went to a couple of others, but I couldn't tell you what. Oh, what's that? We got a key. What do we get? Ugh. RB-PSV1. Well, that's shit. It's one of the underground ones. Right, we're going labs. I'm gonna try and find a cool key code. But yeah, if you haven't seen it, it's called Class Action Park, because that's the nickname it got, because it was like so dangerous. In like 7 year, 8 year span, like 5 people died there. The rides were all incredibly dangerous. They just sort of, the guy that owned the place, they didn't get like engineers in to design them. He just came up with an idea and they build it with just like local people and shit. Like, and you get caught up in thinking, oh man, this is cool. He's just kind of doing what he likes and breaking rules. But the more you read about him, the more you realize he was just a fucking crook.
Excuse me, sir, but it's time to goose.
Thank you.
Mathilde 1289, just Zubed for 17 months.
I see you, motherfucker. Oh, eat shit. But yeah, it's a crazy story. It's a really crazy story. And a great documentary if you like that kind of thing. I swear to God, the PC blocks in here are unbelievable. Like, even if we die now, we're up. We're up massively. But we're here. We're here hunting for cards. Holy shit! So it seems like the best place to get key cards is like on the corner of pretty much any desk in an area where you would expect to get shot. Seems like the best metric. I watched a video about it. It's too many to just remember. But I was like, kind of looks like if you go anywhere like it'll be like that, you know what I mean? It'll be something like that. But down in an area where you're like, yikes, someone's gonna shoot me any second. They seem all right. Can we make it a trifecta of graphics cards? That'd be pretty hype. Whoops. It'll be like next to a PC. Like, I feel like generally if something is lit up and it's like a little desk or a table, that's the clue that there could be a spawn there. Or certainly from what the video implied. And most of the keycard spawns seem to be down in the, on the floor in this area, down there. But also just sort of next to stuff, so... The guy was like, I've seen them spawn here, and there's like... Like, it'll be like there, you know what I mean? Oh, there's Merrin. Someone was telling me about that the other day. What a good key it is. Does anyone know if the PC blocks in labs actually are better? Or if it's a myth that I've concocted in my head? Oh, actually, fuck me, that's worth like 500,000 quid. So the guy was like, you'll find key cards on places like that. I mean, I guess you just need to know. Keep your eyes peeled. Idiot. Idiot! Made me soil myself. I'm not even gonna look. I'm gonna guess that's either a center or Eddie Bingo. My money's on Eddie. It's a center. See, I know. I even know the culprit. It'll be shit like, oh yeah, you can find one there. You know, it's weird. The spawns are always weird for these kind of things. Did I already check these? Yeah, we did. Kappa? I'm not even close to Kappa, dude. I don't think I've even begun it. I know when you look at this kind of play, you think, jeez, this guy must be close to Kappa, but no, surprisingly, I'm not. Well, bless you for thinking that, you know? It's very sweet. Oh, I do have the key for this. Holy shit. I don't know this ammo, I must say. I haven't seen any trip mines in PvE, but I think they're partisans? If I remember rightly, he's the guy that places them. So one of the locations was like round here. It's like there or some shit. Well, I think that's enough greed. That was definitely someone playing a sound effect, but I also heard a noise. I heard someone say something. Where am I? I am there. I just want to get to the labs area. This is where I get lost. Don't know the way to the actual lab from here. The lab exit, the elevators with the lab exit, I can never find them. I always get turned around at this bit. You know where, like, black keycard room and all that lot are? No, but I mean, I know where the extracts are. If I can get to, like, black. I don't know where green is. I only know black and blue. Do you know what I mean? There's that long corridor. Black is at one end, blue is at the other. You go down the staircases, you're at the elevator extracts underground. I'm just trying, I can't remember how to get there. So if I go down... Thank you.
Jump, Alistair!
Flash Artuc, un gifted popolop 37 à subscription. Flash Artuc, un gifted à tire un sub to popolop 37.
Look at that. You helped me out. You get a gift channel. I didn't bother searching the guys I killed because, you know, searching their PMCs is like a huge waste of time, I feel. It's like a 1 in 100 time when they have something good. Scavs I'll search every time I can.
Excuse me, sir, but it's time to goose.
Casbe tiré bas just resubed for 60 months, 5 years of mediocre goonery.
Excellent. So I put some what I would consider some pretty nice stuff in the fucking whatchamacallit, the cultist circle? Shit is how I would call it. Gave me absolute shit back. I was like, alright, I'm done with you. Yeah, they have a lot of grenades. But I feel like, I don't know what they're doing with their time on the map. You can loot them super late on, and they still don't have shit. I am going to take the flur off this because I think it's not actually helping me in these fights. I do quite like the hammer. And then we can put a little mini scope on top of the hammer, I think, is how it works. Although I might just put... What have you got? Have you got a little laser beam? So loud, isn't it? You keep re-rolling. How do you mean? So whatever they give you, you just put back in, you sacrifice again? Does it matter? You're right. I'm sorry, love. God, I really thought that was something cool there for a sec. So these are the spots that this lad spoke about in this video. You can get them in there, but my blue key card is gone. Whoops. And I'm sure there's some way to do it where it like is more likely to pay off, but was not expecting the push. T-Rumbles, Bumbles, just going back to you saying they buffed it. I couldn't see anything in the notes about that, about any buffing. But are you referring to the PMC's loot or the cultist's table? Or sacrificial thing, whatever, sacrificial thing, whatever you want to call it. Because I have found that the PvE loot on PMC's is still terrible. I don't know quite why. Someone running about. Worthless, sadly. Thank you. I saw Glorious E today saying that the best way to... Whoa. The best way to improve your metabolism was to use Gold Star off cooldown. I hear gunplay. Spotting issues on a house viewing. It's a very good question. First of all, I'm assuming you're going to pay a surveyor to do that for you. This could be our death. I would say the best money we spent before getting this place was to pay a surveyor. Someone in, we got a really good guy, he was recommended by other people, he was super thorough, solid, but he understood what he was doing from a sort of first time buyer perspective. So he was like, look, here's all the things wrong with the house. It's quite a list. He was like, this is broken, that is broken, you're going to want to look at this, you're going to want to look at that, this is under-maintained, this is under-maintained. And we were like, we can afford the place. He was like, look, not going to be funny with you, I can see why you like the place. He goes, even given everything I've said, I can see why you like it. It's a charming place, nice area, all the rest of it. But there's always shit. Like, I don't care whose house you go to, there's always shit that needs looking after. You can't get too hung up on small things. The main things I would look for is, and this is from my perspective, as someone who was aiming to be a parent in the foreseeable, it's Is there room for an extension and an expanding the house? That was a big thing for us.
Excuse me, sir, but it's time to goose.
Tepidoc just resubed for 2 months.
So yeah, we kind of looked at it like, is there some terrible subsidence problem? No. Is there the room for expansion? Yes. Is it a nice area? Yes. If we came to sell the place in years to come, would people go, oh my god, it's next to an open sewer? That's the more important stuff. Not, am I going to need to fix the drains? Because probably. Do you know what I mean? Like, if I went around my house now, brutally honestly, and was looking for all the shit that I could probably do with fixing, it's probably a reasonable amount of stuff. Do you know what I'm saying? Not a lot. Yeah, have a look at the neighbours. Also, from a purely snobbery point of view, what are they driving? Really easy marker. Really easy marker. They're all driving beaten up old cars. It's a pretty poor area. If you see some nice cars, some new cars, a couple of nice Mercs, a couple of Audis, probably a better area.
Nice jump, Alistair!
Nejal de Gifted Bagdad tire Bob 2 à subscription. Nejal de Gifted attire un sub to Bagdad tire Bob 2.
Thank you. I'm just trying to pay attention here. Have a think about things like schools. Have a look at the what kind of shops are in the area. You know, would you go there at night? Have a look around there at night. That's a big one. If you're living in London, you're not going to find anywhere that isn't on the crime map in a fairly serious way. But yeah, have a look around. Go there at night time. What's it like? Talk to the neighbors if you can. This scope. The fact we don't have a 1x, big mistake. Big mistake. I thought it was a variable. Oh well.
Little pierce my foot on the spike.
I mean, internet. Three bats is onto a good point, yeah. I mean, I always try to be honest, but I think what would be better is if I gave you just joke answers. Are there lots of burnt out cars in the area? Again, the people are wealthy enough to burn cars for their merriment. Lots of feral children around. If so, fantastic. Feral children can be used for a wide variety of tasks. What do we got? Big gun. That scope can fuck off. What state are you in? It's pretty bad, but we can repair you up. It's that blackout stuff, isn't it? Can we even get any good ammo for this thing? Sweet, we've made a physical Bitcoin. Hard to break. Says it's hard to break. I don't think that's ever what I've... I don't understand what that means. It's okay. It was alright. I found it very difficult to get to grips with. There's a lot to it. I don't think I said it's hard to break. I don't know what that means. I did find it complicated. God bless us. Oh, we need a fucking labs key card. I bet we can't buy another one. Are we out of stock? Nuts. Nuts. Well. Oh, I see. That's unfortunate. I've tried the Deagle. It's all right. I mean, Cat was talking about Deadlock on his side podcast. This is secondhand information. Valve gave Deadlock to some devs from other companies to play, and their analysis was, this feels like a game made for developers. We think this will flop. Interesting. I wonder what that means. I mean, I'll tell you right now. I think it's overly complicated for what it is, which is essentially a shooter. And even though you can say it's not a shooter, and with that lad that was dying on the hill of It's Just Like Dota, you could say, no, it's an FPS MOBA and all the rest of it. I think the issue is, and this is my biggest problem with it, game developers, what that means is that they've made it not thinking about an audience, but thinking about what they and other developers would say. Oh, that's a very clever design decision. So it's like when they say, like, a comic, when they're talking about a comedian who is like, other comedians are like, this guy's amazing. Just like there are some musicians who other musicians are like, this guy is fucking insane. But it's not for the general public. Do you know what I mean? So if you look at Deadlock, and I say this as someone that I've enjoyed playing it, but I could tell 2 or 3 games in, this is not a game I'm going to put 12,000, 13,000 hours into. First game of Dota, I knew I'm hooked on this game. The first game. And I'd already played League and was like, I hate MOBAs. Played Dota and was like hooked immediately. So the issue that they've got is that in Dota, even if you are really bad at clicking, there's a hero for you. But all the things you want to do, and also you can see much more easily from your zoomed out perspective the distance between your enemies and will I land this spell or anything. Yep, I'm in range, you know. It feels much easier to know where you are in terms of, like, the fight. I feel like in Deadlock, I'm never quite sure if I'm in range. A lot of this stuff is very short-ranged and kind of hard to gauge. That's how it feels to a noob. And there's things like, you really need to aim your shit. And if you think about it, you've got your main fire button, the zoom in fire. Then you've got melee attack, power melee attack. So anyway, when it comes to, say, a game where you need to actually aim, you're immediately much harder than any other game of its kind. Because although you need to correctly click on the enemies, I can't miss my Venge stun. And I was saying this the other night, I can't miss. Like, maybe the enemy has an ability that means I miss, but I can't straight up miss. And I feel like, obviously, in Deadlock, you can. And if you think about the skills, I mean, looking at all the stuff you can level up, I mean, my god, it's like a wall of text. It's so much stuff. And yeah, you can learn that stuff. But I don't think most people are willing to put in that kind of time. So, to me, it feels like they've made all these cool things in the game, and it's just too much. It's just too much. It doesn't feel like I can just drop in and have fun. And you could say that's the same with Dota. But first of all, Dota is simpler to play. It's harder to learn the whole thing because there's so much more to it. But it's simpler to just drop in and play, I feel, because you don't need to be good at games to learn enough about Dota for it to be fun. Whereas with Deadlock, I felt like, hold on, so I need to be able to shoot and have the situational awareness of where the other enemies are, and everything's very fast. Everyone's moving around really fast. I felt completely lost even just playing my hero from the start and like jumping around and all the rest of it. I mean, I get it. If you're coming to Dota now, I'm sure it's difficult. I'm sure it's very complicated. But I'm going to keep saying it, and I think this is right. I really do. Is that if you have to aim, you've added a layer of complexity to your game beyond anything that people really expect. And I think people who can aim in games, as well as WSAD sliding around and all that shit, they don't see that as difficult. They're like, it's just aiming. It's not hard. You just point at them and shoot. But for a lot of people, myself included, that is hard. And you're also having to do not just that, but now you're casting spells and you're having to react to the enemy spells and like you can counter their spells and stuff. And there's tons of like the skill ceiling for Deadlock is really high, which I think will attract some players. But in terms of like the average player experience, I don't know. I think it's probably a lot of people are just going to go like, oh man, this is too much and dip. That's how I feel. I mean, you know, go for it. If you disagree, that's fair enough. But I'm just telling you what I thought playing it out of the gate, what my opinion was. My opinion was, holy shit, this is difficult. For good or ill, you know, you can disagree with that all you like. I'm telling you, that was my feeling was, on top of having to learn all the stuff I have to learn in a MOBA, I also have to be jumping around. I have to learn, you know, this very big and quite confusing map. There's a lot of shit going on. There's all these different spells, and there's like neutral creeps. There's this urn thing. There's Roshan. There's four lanes, guys. And so it also requires a huge amount of teamwork, and it's a lot. It is a lot. And I'm sure you're going to disagree, and you'll have some comeback about how, well, it's this, it's that, and the other. I'm telling you how it feels to play. As someone who has played a lot of games, has played Dota for a very long time, it's literally too complicated. I mean, if you also add in cosmetics, I don't know how. I mean, this was the other point I made that I think people are missing. If you look at Dota, there's a lot to learn. I will 100% agree with you there. And I'll say this again, and maybe it'll sink in. When I cast Fisher, it looks the same from every angle, regardless of where you are. It's a big wall of earth. When I cast Venge Stun, it's a stun that shoots out of my hero, and you can see it traveling in the air, and it looks the same every time. Cosmetics aside, in Deadlock, if I'm far away, I might not see what it looks like. There's so much other flashy shit going on, and I'm only looking at this much of the battle. Right? This much. So you've got all this stuff around here that you're not seeing, because they're to your right, to your left, or you're looking at this thing. In Dota, if you're doing stuff, you can see the whole team fight. And you can see Enigma running in on your left. You can see Clockwork come in and hookshot your mates behind you. But in Deadlock, if you're not doing this all the time, your vision is like this. And being able to spin around and still keep tabs of your hero and where you are and the fight and the lanes and which direction, that's a real skill. When you watch people who are good at these games, they can do that. That is not most people. It really isn't. So I think whilst you could say, well, hold on, the fights in Overwatch were very chaotic and there were lots of spells and stuff like that, I never felt like I didn't have some idea of what was happening in Overwatch, and you didn't have the whole lanes situation. Because the thing with Deadlock is, as much as all that Overwatch-style combat and TF2-style, you know, fighting and people jumping off stuff and all this verticality, which is, it felt like there was way more verticality than there was in Overwatch. Loads of heroes just jump in the air, or they're on a building when they're coming out of a... They can come from behind. They can just run around and come out behind you. It's like, holy shit, like, how do we keep up with this? It's a lot. So I think if you are really good at games, I'm sure it looks fantastic because you're like, holy shit, finally, I can stretch my legs and really commit to this really complicated game. But most people are just going to be like, this is too complicated. And I think they're just going to tap out. Which is a shame, because it's obviously a really well-made game. It's beautifully... the look of it, and the hero design and everything, and the sound. But it is so complicated for the average player. In my opinion. So, Wurtzag, I think you might be thinking about its launch at TI. I want to say 5 was really underwhelming, right? Like, they were like, we're announcing something, and everyone was like, holy shit, it's going to be a new hero, it's going to be something cool, and they were like, a card game! And everyone was like, ugh, because Dota fans are just like that. But it was a new Valve game. People were really excited about that.
done.
Yeah, what the fuck? I couldn't even see you, dude. The death noises are so good. What are we discussing? Adverts and Twitch? You are meant to announce that you're doing a sponsored stream. Fact. Whether that always happens or not, I don't know. But most people I know that do sponsored streams put hashtag ad. I'm not saying that happens every time without fail. I'm pretty good about it. I occasionally forget. But I'm trying to think of the occasions I've forgotten, and they're few and far between. But it does happen. But certainly, it absolutely happens that people don't always announce this shit. Or they're like, they get given a code and they think, oh, they just gave me a code. This isn't sponsored. But I mean, you know, Valve probably aren't, in all honesty, Valve probably aren't paying people to play their game. Because I don't think they need to. Like, I'm pretty sure that if Valve said to anyone, would you like a code for our new game, you've automatically created a desirable thing. People that haven't got the game want to see what it's like. Overwatch did the same thing. People forget this. Or maybe they don't. I don't know. Maybe you guys have. Maybe you haven't. When Overwatch came out, you had to get a code. And I remember I got a code, and all the Blizzard fanboys were like, Pyrian, can you get me a code? Pyrian, can you get me a code? And I couldn't. And then they saw the game and they were like, you can keep the code. They weren't interested. They were like really upset. They were super hyped. New Blizzard game. It's the same for Valve. Valve is making a brand new game. A shooter. A multiplayer shooter. Six players a side. Ambitious. It's a MOBA. People want to play it. I don't think Valve is paying people to play the game. I mean, I don't think they need to. Maybe. Maybe they are. I don't know. And as for rules about sponsored content, let's just think for a second. Do you think, and I'm not saying that anybody is doing this, I'm not saying that anybody streaming the game is doing this illegally, I have no inside information. Do you think, in your heart of hearts, that the CMA or whoever are actually keeping an eye on Twitch streamers? I'll wait for your answer, because I'd like to hear it. But I'm curious if you genuinely think that that's a thing that's happening. That any government body is keeping an eye on this shit. No, nobody's fucking watching. No, nobody's fucking watching. It's the Wild West. Like all of these things, it's the fucking Wild West. I don't think the CMA or whomever is keeping an eye on anybody. I really don't. In terms of Twitch streamers. I mean, especially because I don't know which UK or Europe streamers you think would be big enough that this would matter. I really doubt that they're wasting any time on it. They're probably like, look, we don't know anything about this internet stuff. Whatever, we don't really care. That's my feeling. Disagree if you wish. That's absolutely fine. I'm just telling you what I suspect. I really, really doubt that anybody is watching or gives a shit. And I think it's quite sweet that people think that, well, surely there's some oversight. Maybe? Probably not. Because who gives a shit? This isn't coming up in fucking Parliament or something. There's no votes riding on this shit. Nobody cares. It's some internet shit for nerds. For right or wrong, I'm not saying either way. Oh yeah, and that's as it should be. I'm just saying, I don't think anybody gives a shit. Yeah, there's no Red, I agree. This is Valve. Everybody's still got a boner for Valve. It's like this hidden secret company that's like, it's hype that they're doing shit, right? It's like, Valve made a new game? People are gonna fucking play that shit. Like, if you say to them, hey, would you like a code for our new game? If Valve contacted you? I mean, they're still a cool company. You know, because they're not public, because they're not like Blizzard or whatever, because they don't release a new version of John Madden every year. And when they do come out with a game, people are like, holy shit. I don't think that Valve has spent any money on promoting Deadlock. Also, I think it's not doing badly for a game that isn't even out yet. I know, Red. So, I mean, let's look at the Deadlock streams. So, Browse, Deadlock, 91k viewers. 91k viewers for a game that isn't even out. That's pretty good. I think it's one of those things that people want to see it. They can't play it yet. They're giving it to some streamers. And then they've given it to their mates. And they've given it, you know, it's like, that's a cool way of launching a game. I'm not arguing with you, Red, by the way, at all. So I'm assuming you're talking to chat. Oh, can we get one yet? Come on, therapist. Give me a labs key card. Yes. Okay, mate. All right, hold on. Let me resolve this. Elsif, if you could put it into a couple of sentences, what is your position regarding deadlock and just sum up to me what the argument is here. Do you believe that Valve is paying streamers to play deadlock? Is that your position? Why? Why do you think that? What are you basing that on? Genuine question. Okay, so a few things. Valve is not like other companies, genuinely. I genuinely do not think that they are spending money advertising deadlock. I really don't. I don't think they need to. I think they've been quite clever about the launch for this by just giving codes out to people. And I really would be genuinely shocked if they had paid anyone any money to play this game. And I know that that's crazy and that other companies wouldn't think of that. And that you're like, Oreo did this. But they are a large company with, like, a corporate structure and they sell cookies. Valve is a weird company with no corporate structure that is not owned by shareholders, doesn't do things the way other people do, for good or ill, and you're essentially trying to lump them in with regular companies. And I think that's your mistake. I mean, I haven't seen much really about deadlock other than the streaming. Okay. I mean, if you believe that, I don't think I'm going to convince you otherwise. I mean, I don't know what you think they do in terms of advertising, but I mean, there are no ad people the way you think of them. I don't know what you know about the Valve corporate, not even corporate, company structure. But until very recently, they didn't even have a communications person. they just didn't, dude, trust me. Like, they didn't. They had no one there that was, like, talking to the community and shit like that. And I mean, I've worked with them for 12 years, I've known quite a few people there. I think I have a reasonable insight. I'm not an expert. Yeah, but Steam, I don't know if you know how Steam works, but when was the last time you saw an advert for Steam? Like on a subway or something. Even though everybody fucking uses it. I don't know. I've never seen an advert for Steam anywhere. I don't think Valve is a company that really spends a lot of money on advertising. I mean, when even when Dota was at its peak, as far as I could tell, the biggest piece of advertising they had was TI. They didn't promote the game. Oh, hello. They weren't like Dota 2, like. Alright, dude. I just think they have such a big cachet. And they're so well known. And essentially anyone that uses Steam sees their name. So they kind of don't really need to advertise. But it's cool. I mean, if you work in advertising, I honestly sympathize with your failing to understand how they seem to work. Because it feels like no one else does things the way they do, but I'm pretty sure nobody does things the way they do, and that's pretty much the only explanation. They're just a bit special. But I'll see if I can find out. But again, I sincerely doubt that they paid anyone to play their game. I don't think they need to. I mean, when I found out that I could get a key to play Valve's new game, I was hella excited. Also, for Twitch streamers, you know, this could be a big competitive shooter and you could be in on the ground floor of it and all that kind of stuff. That's appealing. That is appealing. Man, the R-Fitter looks huge. Could be right. I just sincerely doubt it. Yeah, go for it, Red. I mean, I personally think it's too complicated for the average player, and I think for MOBA fans like me, why wouldn't I just play Dotes? If it's like, it's like Dotes, but really hard. To me, I'm like, yikes, I can barely aim this shit, and I find this so many buttons. And I'm like, man, I suppose I could learn all this in time, but I don't know. I think it's nice to have a fresh game with a fresh approach. But it is super complicated for me. I mean, I'll play it with the goons. It's a chill game because I have so little understanding of what's happening that I just lose and I'm not even really bothered by it. I don't think the Dota player base is going to move over. I really don't. Certainly, there's a few Dota players I've spoken to that are really enjoying it, but I don't think it'll be a threat, for want of a better word, to Dota, because it is so different. I think, certainly, if you feel that Dota's gotten stale for you, you want a new challenge and you want to learn a new game and all the rest of it, I think it absolutely scratches that itch. But in terms of, like, people that already play Dota and enjoy it, I can't imagine them going, you know what, I think I'm going to play Deadlock from now on. I can't see that. I can't see that happening. Artifact the game, I think, is a really good game. And again, they did something different. The three lanes thing, I mean, you could say they're a little obsessed with lanes. I also think it's funny that they couldn't even make a game with three lanes. They had to make it with four. You can't have anything with three in it, right? Dota was the last thing they made that had three anything in it. But I don't think it's going to be a failure. I mean, I'm sure it cost a bunch to make, and it's a lot of dev time and everything. And it's super cool. I mean, I don't know how much they've put into, like, fucking voice actors and stuff. My God, like, you got all that design work for the characters and the backgrounds. It's beautiful. Huge amount of attention to detail and deep skill involved in making the game, and it all... In classic Valve fashion, it all looks and feels really cool. Artifact didn't suffer from being a bad game. It suffered from being a bad launch. And I think the actual handling of... hold on. Sorry, let me just... Oh, hello. I think what they struggled with more was the monetization of the cards. I think that's what really fucked Artifact, was how the hell do we... make money from this? Because cosmetics isn't going to cut it this time. So we need some kind of strategy where people have to buy cards or whatever. And I think they fucked that. Certainly from all the conversations I saw with TCG guys, they were like, oh man, this sucks. It's too hard to do this. There's no ranked mode. There's no that mode. All the stuff that, you know, Magic seems to have figured out. Whatever, for whatever reason, Valve didn't figure that out for Artifact ahead of time. And I think that's what cost them. I certainly... Certainly that's what I remember the complaints being. Thank you. Sit down. Oh, Half-Life 2 was unbelievable. I mean, you know, if you played it 10 years after it came out or whatever, I'm sure it wouldn't seem great, but my god, when that came out, I played nothing else. Just loved it. It does give me motion sickness. It's the only downside to it. I mean, I think one of the things that makes Half-Life 2 kind of timeless is it's not even about the graphics. The world design was so good, and it's got issues. Issues like the fucking level where you're jumping around and shit. Isn't that in 2 or is that in 1? The one where you are on the alien world. I can never remember if that's 2 or 1. But I mean, I'll never forget moments in that game. The first time you're in, like, what is it, Ravenholm or something like that, and you see that thing chasing you on the rooftops. Good God, I shit my pants. Such a great moment, you know. That's 1. That was the worst part of 1. But yeah. I mean, I won't be going to many games because it's just it's something I could do, but it's like the whole weekend basically fucked. Like, I'll drive down in the morning, which on the M3 is never fun. Drive down there, beers before the game, watch the game, go out afterwards, stay the night in Bournemouth, come back hungover Sunday morning, and it's fun. But there's a number of problems. First of all, getting tickets is not easy for any Premier League games. And even though I know people that work for the club, it's not like I can just get tickets, you know what I mean? So that's one problem. It's very expensive going to games. And it's just like, you know, it's going to cost me a bunch in petrol and... It's a big ask. And it means me saying to Mrs. F, spending the whole weekend away. I know you've been at work all week, but see ya. Whereas my mates who live in Bournemouth, you know, they can go to the game. Whereas for me, it's like it's just a bit more of an ask. And when it comes to watching them live, it's like Saturday 3 o'clock or Sunday 4 o'clock or whatever. It's like, okay, so normally I'm either streaming or taking a break from streaming and having a lie down. So it's just the timing is kind of bad for me. Can you hear them saying that, Red? Yeah, PMCs abound. I've seen Stankrat chuck impact grenades in here just as the doors close. Oh man, I think we just got a very profitable lab run with no keys. Let's check out what we got.
Kierantevise tiré badge Strozubed for 42 months, life, the universe and everything.
Thank you. I'm going to sell it all, and we'll see what how much we got. Shit, I've got a pack tomorrow. I fucking hate going away. Used to be so excited to travel. And now I'm just like... ugh. Luckily, this is the shortest journey for a TI I've ever had. Obviously. And it's like... that is amazing. I'm really looking forward to just having such a short flight. But incredibly selfishly, having to be away for that long, like 2 weeks... and then I've got three more things this year where I'm going to be away for extended periods. And as someone who generally doesn't like leaving the house, let alone leaving the country, it's just kind of a ball ache. Very, very selfish of me to say that, because I know a ton of people who would give their left nut to go to TI, and I get it. It doesn't change the fact that for me, going away is like, fuck, I've got to pack everything and the stress of travel. I hate travel. It just really gets me down. All right, so a spear. I think we've already got like three of those knocking about somewhere that we brought back. Where are they? I think they're all in the thick weapons case, which is mysterious. Oh, here it is. Got one in there. We'll get rid of you. We don't fucking need you. Okay. But it'll be nice to see everybody. We're always well looked after at TI. That's really nice. It seems like a minor thing, but having like, you know, just being looked after and having all your everything taken care of and your flights and everything, it's nice. It's nice. It's a nice feeling. And you feel like your work there is valued and all the rest of it. And then, you know, things like, for example, having my voice line in the game and stuff, it feels cool. I love that side of things. How much are you going for? Probably not that much. 1.5. Oops. Sweet. So, Red, I'm assuming, I think rightly, that they're going to be like, before the tournament, they'll have some sit-down conversation where they're like, all right, listen. You know this shit's in the game. We know this shit's in the game. If you fucking abuse this shit, auto disqualification. Like, just absolute auto. So I guess they're probably spending that on just Steam. I mean, I know that when we did like, I mean, here's the thing, Deadlock isn't even out yet. Do you know what I mean? Like that maybe they paid Shroud a ton of money to play the game, but I still just don't think they need to. And a guy like that is going to be like, I guess he would do it? I don't know. I feel like a lot of these guys, maybe they would just because it's extra cash, but he certainly has played a lot of it. Seems to be enjoying it a lot. But I honestly don't think Valve is paying streamers. I don't think they see the value in it, to be honest with you. So the Midas bug, and there are a few of them, is that... You can, by the way, I'm just doing lab runs because it's just fun. If we can get a key, we can. I'll ask around and see if anybody knows anything. I mean, I probably can't tell you guys, actually. There's not much point, really. Maybe they did. Maybe they changed the way they do things. Possible. I mean, if you've looked up an advertising budget for them, I imagine that they're spending it on Steam rather than anything else. Steam makes a shitload of money, and I don't think anything else makes anything. I don't think there are many things on the fucking planet that make as much money as Steam does. I don't know if TI and CSGO count as advertising. It could. I think if I was running TI and CS and stuff and funding it, that would go under marketing budget. How much money do I need to sponsor you to play in a Hoymageddon? I don't need money to play in a Hoymageddon. I'd do it. If the lads were playing Hoy, I'd do it. Why not? There are issues. Issue number one, some people are much better. Issue number two, it runs like ass. because it's a Paradox game and it desyncs and crashes all the time. Issue number 3, it takes a whole fucking evening to play. And if someone DCs, do we wait for them or do we just crack on? Like, what's the deal there? I assume this is a locked area. I just want to find a key card. One time. Pig Dog, which game? Tarkov or Deadlock? Another Glock, sweet. Oh, Tarkov? Oh no, dude, it's really addictive. I mean, you're watching me play a really sweaty map, and I'm playing it really quite slowly. And this is PvE, so it's way more... chill. We're dead. These guys are pushing me the way players do, only I'm still alive for the time being. God, these lads aren't fucking about. I mean, that was pretty rough. MZ Dunk. We got one of them. Oh man, he had like a P90 or some shit. I think you're referring to COVID times. The greatest era of streaming that our people will ever know. Every streamer I know is like, oh man, COVID. Isn't that terrible? Oh, it's just like, oh, it was so good. Loads of people watched. Nobody had anything better to do. It was the golden age. It really was the golden age of streaming. Ah, the old PPSH in a sling. Damn good times. I don't think we can buy another labs key, unfortunately. I think she's going to say, fuck off. Yeah, we got to wait. How long do we have to wait? 45 minutes for a restock. So we'll go somewhere else. Fine, I'll go somewhere else. I don't know if this ammo is any good. Oh, it's jolly good. Sorry. If Matt Hancock streamed instead, he'd probably have stayed out of trouble. I think during the pandemic, we streamed Dotes, Tarkov. That ought to do it, eh? Let's go to reserve. Get my reserve keys. Have we got my reserve keys? These aren't my reserve keys. Here they are. Oh yeah. Oh, and some meds. You fool. Oh, and some grenades. Do you know what's funny? I never used to use grenades and ammo and good armor. I wish I'm wondering if... I mean, in PvP, I'm pretty sure I'd still just get my fucking ass kicked. That's the problem. This game makes you think you can actually play because you're playing against fucking robots. Oh yeah, TOS. I mean XCOM, sorry, TOS, XCOM. Dotes, XCOM, Tarkov. Did we do Rust? Was Rust during COVID? No. No, not Skylines. Probably did some Rimworld and stuff. I mean, it was like a year, wasn't it? It was like a year long. people not going into the office and all the rest of it. I do think Tarkov probably featured. Like, it's crazy to me to think that COVID was 4 years ago now. Is it hard, Cha-Cha? Raiders and PMCs. What a fucking slaughter. These guys did not have a good day. I think, in hindsight, lockdown was... My mate at the time said lockdown was a huge mistake, and I was like, we don't know what we're dealing with. I think we have to play it safe. And he was like, the economic downfall or fallout from this is going to be enormous. And everybody was rightly, you know, being like, people are dying, and it felt like there's no way that you could say that it was a bad idea. Like, it felt like it was an obviously good idea. But looking back, I am really not sure. I think that lockdown and eat out to help out and all those schemes were probably an absolute load of wank and did nothing. And I think that the recovery has been agonizing. Inflation and all the COVID denial stuff and all that. I think it's been the effects of COVID were brutal. Didn't Sweden not lock down at all? There were countries that didn't lock down, right?
Excuse me, sir, but it's time to goose.
Phil se goûte just resubed for 5 months. Take my pin.
Merci beaucoup. I know that certainly, like you said, hospitals were fucking overloaded. But I know that the point we're at now, like, I suppose the question is, if you lock down and say, no, we have to stop the spread of the disease. If you think about where we are now, I know tons of people who get COVID. Pretty much every week, I'm like, someone I know has got COVID somewhere. And it's no worse now than someone saying, I've got a cold. And the reason is, it's been out there in the wild for long enough. And like any good disease that wants to spread and be successful, if you like, in the old disease career stakes, you don't want to be dangerous. You want to be like the common cold, the most successful disease ever, right? Because still everybody gets it. RB PSP1 and PS... Oh, those are the underground areas, I think. So when we said, all right, we're going to lock down so no one can get it, did we delay that happening? I don't know. I genuinely don't know. I don't know what the correct thing to do would have been. I think that was the problem, is understandably, governments were like, we're going to play it safe and we're going to restrict people's movement and wear masks until we figure out what the fuck this is, because this could be disastrous. And I think that a lot of the sort of models that they were being given by scientists and stuff like that was just, we don't know what this is going to do. We don't know what this is going to look like. We've got all these projections. If we go for the worst case scenario, this is what it will look like. And whatever they showed the politicians must have been like, they must have shit themselves. Because even Donald Trump was like, we need a vaccine. Do you know what I mean? This is a guy who's probably like, I mean, he said some crazy shit. He doesn't even know what a disease is, I would guess. I mean, influenza is still a huge killer of old people. We don't lock down every winter just in case old people get the flu. So I guess from some perspectives, you could say, like, feels like, why this? But when it first came out, I'll tell you for a fact. When I had it, if my mum had caught that, she would have died. 100%. I thought I was going to die. And I'm a, relatively speaking, healthy man, like, compared to people with respiratory problems or like heart, congenital heart defects, or that are just old. I honestly thought I was gonna die. It was that bad. Now, if we had said, oh, we're not going to lock down, it'll be fine, I honestly think an awful lot more people would have died. Like, a lot more people. For me, it was the fever, the aches, the inability to eat or sleep, the whole glut of things that I was hit by, what felt like all at once, was just unbelievable. Unbelievable how much it hurt. Just literally, physically hurt to do everything. It was fucking horrible. Like, I was literally incapable of even drinking water for a full 24 hours. And I think when that first winter hit, and I had it, I mean, it's bad, dude. Like, those early COVIDs were so fucking bad. No, I can't imagine that. Sounds terrible. The weird thing is, when I had it, it wasn't that things tasted bad. They didn't taste of anything. I remember I ate an orange. Because I wanted some liquid. Like, I was so dehydrated. And I had an orange. Just to smell it and to suck on it was like some sensation that I was consuming something, because I hadn't eaten for so long. My wife was able to feed me a little bit of yogurt with honey in one day, and that was like heaven, because I was just like able to eat something. And if I was stuck like that, killed all these scavs. I did have the flu once before, which I thought was the worst I'd ever had. Went to China for Star Ladder. Probably 2017, 2018. And I got the flu. and I'd never been sicker until that point when I got COVID. It was... coughing was unbelievable. Unbelievable. Like, you can't describe the feeling. You're coughing so much, you think, I must be about to cough up blood any moment. And the pain, oh my god, every time I coughed, it was like razor blades in my body. It was horrific. And I remember thinking, man, I hope I never get... that sick again, like ever. And then I got COVID and I was like, okay, this is the sickest I've ever been. I was wrong. Think my mag drills should be much better than they apparently are.
I am gonna kill each and every last one of you motherfuckers!
Sneaky little bastard. Some of the sunglasses have a chance to deflect bullets because Russians. I mean, there's a beanie hat that has a chance to deflect bullets, right? But in essence, they do nothing. Worst food poisoning I ever had was also at a Dota event. New York. Madison Square Garden Theater. Probably like 2014. Seb was on the panel. Me, Malk, and Seb were the panel. I dressed in a tweed suit with a flat cap. And Ice 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 and Black were on the winning team, whichever team that would have been back then. I can't remember the name of it. A dreadful tournament. Dreadful tournament. Not because the Dota was especially bad, but they made us play, they made the players play on these ultra, this was the era of the ultra thin laptop. When it all of computer, so all the computers had to be ultra thin for reasons unknown. They thought it was cool. And it just meant that they ran like shit. And they would constantly die. And we had a hold up at one point that was... Mid-tournament, 2 hours. How mad is that? All the players just sat there. And they were like, we think it's the lights on the computers. And was like, yeah. What are you going to do about it? I'm like, oh, well. We'll wait for them to cool off. I have used a red flare, yeah, it worked. But yeah, we at the after party, there's all this catered food, and somehow I got food poisoning, and I mean bad. Went back to the hotel that night. I wasn't even especially drunk. I did get pretty drunk, but it wasn't that. It was whatever I'd eaten, whatever they were giving out, someone had fucking done something to the food, or it just wasn't well looked after or whatever. Because I was vomiting, I was shitting everywhere. I spent the whole day just on the toilet. And I went to a Walgreens and bought as many anti-feeling like anything that I could buy that was for your guts, I would buy it. And I bought this stuff that was like, had bismuth in, I think. And it turned my shit looked like it was made of metal. It was fucking horrendous. And on the Sunday, I was going home that day, and I was going to meet my friend. We're going to do the High Line walk. It's like an old subway line that they've turned into a garden. This is in NYC. I was like, hey, yeah, we'll meet up. We'll go out. It'll be fun. And I called her up and I was like, I can't make it. I'm sick. I've been on the toilet for 24 hours. She was like, I'll take you to the deli. We'll get you some chicken noodle soup. She's Jewish. And she was like, I'll look after you. Got me some chicken noodle soup. Took me to the deli. Got a corned beef sandwich. Felt much better. She drove me to the airport, which was really good of her. She's like one of my oldest friends. God bless her. Looked after me in my weakened state. And do you know what this is the funniest part of it? Is that my roommate at this event, they were so stingy we didn't get our own rooms, right? My roommate at the event was Seb. And I didn't know this. I just met the guy. Like, I don't remember him as a pro. He'd had a very short pro career and then stopped and was doing panel work and stuff like that. So I get to the hotel, didn't realize I was sharing, and there's Seb and his girlfriend. I was like, oh. And they were like, oh. I was like, I think this is my room. He goes, yeah, yeah, we're sharing. I was like, oh shit, that's awkward. And we all shared a room for one night. And then they quickly found somewhere else to stay. But if they hadn't, they would have had to be there with me having the shits. It would have been awful. I would have felt so embarrassed. How does that kind of planning happen? Because most events back in the day didn't make much money, and the guys who ran them were understandably stingy. The first event I ever worked, I had to share with a member of the production crew. Never met him. German guy working for what became ESL. What back then was just called Turtle Beach or whatever. Maybe they were still called ESL. They certainly weren't the big name they are now. They were tiny. It was in a hotel in Katowice in Poland. That was the first event I was ever hired for. And they were like, we saw your... video where you did interviews at a UK Dota LAN. I was like, LAN? When I extract this, I'll show you the video. It's funny for a couple of reasons. Oh, dude, I'm not saying I like it. My rider, if you like, pretty quickly became, what's my rate? And we'd discuss that. And then I'd say, I'm not sharing a room. And I did have a decent reason, to be fair, which is that I do genuinely get night terrors. And I'm like, I don't know if I want to get night terrors with someone I don't know. Because... I've tried to kill Mrs. F a few times, and I've definitely tried to throw myself out of a window many times. And if I wake up and someone I don't know in my dream state is there in the room, shit's gonna get unpleasant. I also shared a room with Draskal at DreamHack. Probably would have also been around 2014, 2015. Maybe 2014. I was on the main panel with James, and oddly enough, in Toby paneled, and James just took the piss out of him the whole time. Oh god, that was funny. James is still a guy, whenever we get together, we both get steaming drunk and talk about the old days. And we both got quite a similar sense of humor. He's just a smart guy. Very helpful. If you ever need guidance or you're not sure about something, when I first started off, I did the Katowice stuff, and then I did the kickoff season of Dream League. Oh god, the game's crashed, you knobhead. Find this vid.
Excuse me, sir.
Thank you.
But it's time to goose.
Ugly caveman just resubed for 49 months.
Thank you. Elba. Boom! Welcome to Pyrian Flag. Ignore that. Eleven years ago. Meet the guys.
How you doing?
Just watch this vid. My mates did this. Boom! This is Perry and Flax here, coming to you live from Piccadilly Circus. This is our Trocadero Centre here, HMB Gamer Base. We've got the Dota 2 Cup of some sort being played out. 50 guys in there, 10 teams, all UK-based, and they're playing today for mouse mats and mouse pads and cables and stuff. Let's go inside because it's freezing. The old Orphic screen. We're here inside now, thank goodness. Inside Gamer Base of London. Oh, don't breathe in, but here they are, 50 players warming up. Their fingers are twitching, their mouses are flying, and the keys are already clattering as we warm up the first round of group stage matches. Let's have a look. The old HUD. A lot of hair in the room. Let's get a look at some of the haircuts. First round of matches are just about to get underway. Team Infused against Core Miss, maybe. Let's check out the action.
Heal me up now. Heal me up.
That's King Dave, that guy on the left. UK Dota legend.
Oh, Neil! Oh,
dude, it just went wrong for Paige.
Neil, what the fuck, man?
And up on top, Bounty Hunter. Have there been sentries dropped? No? No.
Who's that casting? To come up towards it. Who's that casting? That's Gareth Bateson, a.k.a. Durka Durka Dota.
Have there been sentries dropped? No? No sentries dropped, so he is clear to come up towards XP range.
Here with Team Core Miss, maybe. Just had a big upset, defeated Team Infused. Let's meet the guys.
How you doing? I'm Neil Gatetcher.
Hey, Magic Laws.
David Soul, hey, King Dave.
I'm Initiative.
Arsenal.
Team Captain. And something of an upset. How'd it go? So anyway, I did that. And then, I don't even think there's any kind of VOD of No, that's CSGO. I think this was even before Twitch was a big thing. I can't find any evidence. EMS1, Katowice, was it? It wasn't 2013, was it? EMS raid call. EMS one summer. Spring 2013?
Welcome to the Raid Call EMS 1 Spring Finals.
Oh, there I am.
Hunting after the centaurs, Buckingham's here as well, and now, oh, the sun! He got him while he's in the shooky! He didn't even see him! The rocket comes out, and the void from the Night Stalker! He can
A young Kuro. Some really old names here.
Alchemist, a nice four star, gets himself down to the low portion of the ground.
So that was the first event I ever worked. That was the first event I ever watched. Oop. I've ever worked. IreLAN, Shane's mum and friend cast some Dota. Ogre versus TFK. That's on my channel, IreLAN Grand Finale.
You introduce the Dire heroes, who's playing what, and I'll introduce the Radiant. So you go ahead and go first.
Dire, right, okay. So we got, oh my god, who's moving the camera around? Are you
me.
Doing that?
I'm doing
All
it
right,
for me.
So they're seeing your screen, so
yeah,
I can just do whatever I want.
You could do it.
This is IreLAN Grand Final, Ogre versus TFK. Me and Lewis did this in October 2014. So that must have been the first IreLAN. If anyone can find this, oh, hello.
You want a pint?
Yeah, I'll get one. All
right. Look at young Sheebs, young me, and young Scriff.
Yeah, the 2.5 hour game of Dota. I think probably all in.
2.5 hour game of Dota did last.
We're one game in.
There's Shane.
Don't walk in front of the camera. Yeah. Come on, lad.
Crawl. You get down there and
get on your
you
knees.
Get down there and crawl.
So, just to be clear, if you look at the people in this shot... She's like the premier host in Dota. He's one of the two premier observers in Dota. Shane basically runs Dota at ESL, and then you got Muggins. Like, all of these guys went on to much greater things, and... Who have we got doing
game
the interviews?
In, one game into IreLAN.
Don't walk in front of the camera.
Owen and Mudquiz.
Munt and Owen.
Thanks, Ted. Thank you very much. The mic's on. Everyone, we have got one of the winning members of course, Team Potato Farmers Union. And it is, of course, Muntikus himself in person. Now, there we go. Yeah, your fans are already incredibly vocal. We have Muntikus. Let's talk to a little bit about what you did this game, because you took a hero mid that we don't awfully see mid a lot, and a hero that we don't see a lot at all. I mean, has 6.85 changed that, or is this something that you were just doing anyway?
Well, it was something I was trying out before. I usually try and play Doom off lane with Atos. It's a bit of a weird item, but with the sort of Scorched Earth and the Doom, it becomes like really easy to just kill one person. You Doom them and your Atos and the Scorched Earth, it's like a guaranteed kill. So I tried playing it mid because Doom got buffed to Scorched Earth and Level Death. So I think he's a pretty strong laner, but you can't really pick him into like any team, so he's not like overpowered.
Okay, and in terms of the build, you picked up the Atos, and I can't remember if you picked it up by the end of the game, but you picked up a Soul Boost. So were you looking to pick up the Octarine? Was that the next time on the menu? And I guess in terms of the Atos Octarine build, was there a reason why you did it this game? Would you have done it regardless of what heroes you were playing against, or were there certain heroes that are in the lineup that you're like, this could really screw them over?
Generally, if you pick up Atos against people that don't have any escapes, it's just, like, super good, because, I mean, they didn't have any escapes apart from Windrun, which is just like a movement speed buff. So other than that, I mean, usually you just go Octarine, because then it reduces the cooldown on Doom, and then you get lifesteal, so it makes you really beefy. It's better just go a really beefy item than sort of DPS item on Doom, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, this was, you know, I don't know what that other team was about. I don't know, you know, some teams are going to come up with names like that, unfortunately. But yeah.
I mean, in terms of that game, there was a couple of times where you managed to push into the high ground. You got into the base, you went a little bit balls deep, and sometimes it went not too great for you guys. Well, thank you very much, Munterka.
So if you look, this is just in a hotel function room. And we had Red. I reckon there must have been 100 PCs in there. Maybe 80? It was a lot. Because there's, like, all these rows. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6... maybe 7 rows of 5, and then there's another bunch of rows on the other side. There's a lot of PCs, and it was very hot in there, and B, the power in the hotel and the internet in the hotel could not handle anything like the amount of power that we were putting through it. To give you some idea of how bad it was, the trip for the fuse kept going. It would just go, and we would, and this is like a big switch, because this is like the mains for this room. It's like a big switch, so we just taped the switch up with gaffer tape. That was the solution, and we got loads of extension leads and just ran them down corridors and plugged them into any socket we can find that wasn't the ballroom. But there's the mains cable coming into the fuse box, and then obviously it disseminates from there. It was too hot to touch, and that was through the insulation and the paint. The owner didn't give a fuck. He was like, oh, whatever you lads need. It was bad. And the internet, we couldn't get it to work. And then one of Shane's lads worked for like BT. He was like, I'll pop to the office and get some kit. And he turned up with this thing and just fixed the internet. Which hotel was it? I might be able to tell you. It was in Dublin. There's a main road with like, there was a big march going on down the road. There was a, the road had stuff in the middle of it. I know I'm not helping. There was like, it was like in the city center, there was a road with like a gappy bit in the middle, and then another road. Like, so it was like almost like a dual carriageway right in the middle of town. There was a big anti-birth control thing, march. Get your rosary, keep your rosaries off our ovaries was the chant, which I think was a great chant. But yeah, there was some big old hotel there. But yeah, it was fucking great. It was so fun. And the desk that we had, these screens go up and down. And the way they go up and down is that Shane's dad built this thing under the desk. His dad built this desk just before the tournament. And he put a power drill into the socket and ran it. And it made the screens come up out of the table. It was so good. Oh, man. Great times. See, I miss that. That's what Dota doesn't have anymore. Stuff like that and Epic Clan. God, that's loud. So that's Kenwin, who is now he works for ESL as well. He's like the tournament director. So he's the guy that gets all the teams and the lobbies and all that kind of stuff for ESL events. There he is. That is hilarious.
Dwayne the John Roxon.
Dwayne the Jock Ronson. Oh, look, here we go. Who's this?
It's been a long weekend for you guys. Obviously, I guess your voices are pretty spent. Am I right in saying that? You can don't have to reply if it's that bad.
I'm not trying to sort of cry or anything, but I did come here with a bad throat, and this hasn't helped. My missus said you've got to take a week off doing anything, and luckily I'm going on holiday on Tuesday, so
nice.
Yeah, I'll get a rest. It's only Bristol, you know.
Oh well.
Lovely Bristol.
That's me and Gareth. And that's Joe's show. 10 years ago. Durka Dota. Durka. Yeah, he was, believe it or not, he was my co-commentator. I was the caster, he was the color and expert comms. And all we did was fucking drink. I don't know if there's any VODs from the Insomnia series lands. If there are, I can't find them. Anyway. I might stream tomorrow. I've got quite a lot to do. I've got to wash and pack and shit like that for TI. And then I'll be away for a little over 2 weeks. So yeah, cheers. I will do something tomorrow evening. Maybe I'll play some dotes with the boys or something with Munt and the lads, but yeah, failing that, I'm sure I'll see you guys tomorrow at some point. And it's nice to reminisce. I've been doing this for such a long time. Look at Barry in 2017. That was the thumbnail for Barry. That is hilarious. Everyone was so much younger. Just good times. Good times. Anyway, I'll see you guys later. Peace.